Hey everyone, Zach here, just to give you guys a heads up that on this particular episode, we experienced quite a bit of technical difficulties throughout the recording process, so the audio quality isn't quite as up to snuff as what we are used to here at History Boys HQ. Our service that we were using pretty much fucked us over, and we had to record multiple times just to get this episode out. Currently, we're looking into different solutions to make sure that this never happens ever again. Thank you so much, and let's get on with the show. It's time for Tilden with the History Boys!
Yeah! Everybody, we are the History Boys back again. I am Christopher Whedon.
I'm Tyler Armitrout.
He's currently he's jamming a giant burrito into his mouth.
It's about the size of his newborn.
It is the grossest thing I've ever seen.
I usually say, and I'm a history boy, but I've completely forgot to do that part because I was so enamored with Tyler stuffing a burrito in his face.
Yeah,
I can see it.
I'm a history boy and a burrito boy.
I'm a history boy. I forgot to say that, but I'm going to keep going.
I'm Zach Mack. I'm also a history boy.
And I am Jerry Nash, and I am also a history boy.
You guys, I'm so excited. I feel like when we do episodes that are relevant to what's going on in the world, which is, you know, pretty much every episode, you know, minus one or two here and there, I always feel like you know, it makes me not only more excited about history, but it makes me more excited about current events in the world around me. It makes me more curious. So yeah. I'm excited about this.
It's making me a very curious boy wanting to know what's going on in the world.
Yeah. I'm looking in my neighbor's window, looking in the shop windows as I'm going down the street, seeing what they're putting on the shelves, you know?
Yeah.
It's good.
Just following around the guy who's filling the shelves at the grocery store in the middle of the night at a 24-hour grocery store. Just following him around, asking questions about his personal life.
Yeah.
This podcast has led me to do that, is what I'm saying.
Specifically, as it should.
Being like, where'd you grow up? And they tell you at first, and you can see him getting a little more annoyed. They're annoyed right away, because nobody... Who wants that? Yeah, he's a night stalker at a grocery store.
You're like, hey, cool, check. Where's the Rice-A-Roni? Also, where were you born?
Yeah. He's like, Columbus? Wait, why are you asking me that?
All right, what are we doing today, Jerry? Tell us the story.
Well, today I have a tale of two elections.
Ooh.
Elections back to back. Now, our country has had some bonkers elections. We were all alive to see the Bush v. Gore 2000 election.
Oh, yeah. I was there.
Certainly, it was one of the strangest in United States history. The back-to-back elections of 1872 and 1876 were particularly crazy for some of the same reasons as 2000 and 2020, but for some other more unexpected reasons as well.
Al Gore didn't invent the internet yet. Yeah. That's why.
And back then,
if you wanted to be a reality TV star, you had to like just set up a... I mean, it's just being in a play. You're just in a play all the time. Yeah. There's no TV yet. So you just set up a stage, and the stage has a toilet, the stage has a bed, the stage has a kitchen. You just live in your life, you know?
Yeah. And like a cowboy rides up and just shoots you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And that's your whole life.
Yeah.
That's the way it used to be back then.
Yeah.
Cowboy, if you didn't like someone, you could just shoot him in the face, get on a horse, and ride away.
Shit.
I think I heard a couple country songs like that.
They done shot the mayor.
Yeah.
Well, I guess you're a mayor now.
sounds like this town needs an election.
Well, our story starts in Amherst, New Hampshire, on February 3rd, 1811, when a man by the name of Horace Greeley was born.
There's a name.
Yeah. You guys ever heard of him?
Nope.
No.
I haven't.
Really? I remember them mentioning him once in high school.
Do you remember how we just did that thing for our Patreon where he quizzed us all and we didn't know shit? even though we talked about it in the podcast.
This is true. This is true.
Who do you think you're talking to?
Surprise you, dude. Yeah.
Horace Greeley was on the negative $5 bill.
That wouldn't surprise me if such a bill existed.
He was on an early game show on MTV in the 80s. Like Jon Stewart.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, many attribute the fact that he couldn't breathe for the first 20 minutes he was alive to what many believe his Asperger's syndrome.
Oh,
so
shit.
So he couldn't breathe for the first 20 minutes he was alive, and they're like, that's why he has Asperger's. I don't know if that's how it works, but...
It was the vaccines.
Woof.
Yeah.
I was joking about the vaccines thing. You guys are like, uh-oh.
I will say, I feel really bad about being like, he should be on the negative five. You're like, he has Asperger's. You monster.
Yeah.
No. Well, what's crazy to me is that he couldn't fucking breathe for 20 goddamn minutes. Your first 20 minutes, like, out of your mom's cooch, and you can't breathe. So, at this point, is he the living dead? Because no one came back.
I think he had trouble breathing. You know what I mean?
And I mean, it's all uphill from there, you know? Your first 20 minutes, like, you're ready for anything at that point.
Yeah, he's like, just throw me and I'll be like a deep sea diver. I can hold my breath for like 20 minutes.
Like Guybrush Threepwood.
No.
Monkey Island.
Yes.
Monkey Island reference?
Yeah, Guybrush Threepwood could hold his breath for a while, like 10 minutes maybe. I don't know.
Oof. He was a brilliant boy. He learned to read at the astonishing young age of 4. His family was poor, however, so a wealthy neighbor of theirs actually offered to put up the cash to give the young Horace a good education. But Horace's father, Zacchaeus, I think that's how you pronounce it, Zacchaeus, he was too proud to accept the charity, however, and he declined, which is crazy.
That's a classic old man. He's like, I'll take care of your family.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah,
he could have just traded one of the C's in his name. He could have traded the whole last syllable and just had a regular name, like Arzak.
He could have gone by Z, which would have been cool.
There you go.
Just Z.
I'm Z, brother.
Yeah.
I don't need your money, man. I'm Z.
Another wealthy neighbor actually let Horace, like, read all the books in his personal library, which, you know, was pretty cool of him to do.
Which were all erotica that he created.
Yeah.
I was about to say, it was all his personal, like, his sex diaries.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And like, there's also a lot of pictures, mostly hand-drawn pictures of him with a really long penis, and he was way buff.
Yeah.
And he's like, how come you don't look like this in real life? He's like, I do.
You gotta get your eyes checked, kid.
Zacchaeus was a hired hand, and he was terrible with money. And in 1820, he fled New Hampshire with his family to settle in Vermont, or else he'd be thrown in a debtor's prison. So he's running away from that.
Sally Mae is what he was running away from.
Yeah, there you go.
I was going to say, like Ned Kelly's dad.
Yeah, well, kind of.
He's going to end up with Ned Kelly. Oh, wait, no, that was kind of Scottish. Fuck. that's why I don't do voices.
Yeah. I mean, didn't Ned Kelly's dad went from, was it Ireland to Australia?
Yeah. Yes.
Whereas this guy, Zagreus, went from New Hampshire all the way to Vermont.
To Vermont. Yeah, the arduous journey to Vermont.
Ugh. Home of Ben and Jerry's and socialism.
So in 1822, at the age of 12, Horace ran away from home to go be an apprentice to a printer, because he loved books so much he wanted to learn how to make them.
I'm starting to like this kid already.
Yeah.
I have a feeling I'm going to eat my words about that, though.
You'll see. Now, the printer told him that he was way too young to be his apprentice, and he kind of shooed him away. You know? Like, get out of here.
You're too young to be a printer's apprentice. Now go to the smoggy factory and go work there.
Yeah. You got to work up from the coal mines if you want to be a printer's apprentice.
But at the age of 15, he finally got a job as a printer's apprentice.
After 3 years of constant begging.
Yeah, exactly. That's not too far off.
So many hats and fake mustaches. Sorry, Zach.
No, it's all good. I thought it was a 3-year-long internship. That's how we got hired on.
Unpaid internship.
Unpaid internship, exactly.
Yeah.
He made up for an experience and exposure.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
And it was weird how much mining coal he had to do.
Yeah, right.
Considering it was a
printers don't run themselves. They run on coal like everything else.
Yeah. And kids pushing a big wheel.
Yeah. And that's how you end up with an army of illiterate child Conan the Barbarians, because they push that wheel, and then they grow up, and they're all buff, and then they go around punching donkeys.
Yeah. Like that movie.
Like that movie, Red Dawn, the John Milius one.
The John Milius.
Yes.
So Horace's appetite for reading was Terrarian. He read nearly everything in the local library.
You just gonna drop a word like Terrarian on me?
Yeah.
Yeah, like he's like Terrar.
I was referencing Terrar in that.
Oh.
Yeah.
Dude couldn't get enough.
The fact that he couldn't.
Everyone else get that but me?
Yeah, I
guess so.
That's the way it's looking.
So when the first paper that he worked for closed, he moved to Pennsylvania to live with his family for a short time, but he wanted to publish his own newspaper. So in 1831, he moved to New York City to open his own paper.
Let me guess, he decided to open up the New York Post?
No. I was thinking that too.
Thank you.
That already existed.
It is.
Written by Alexander Hamilton. I've mentioned that on the show before. Yeah. I'm also related to him. I've mentioned that on the show before.
Yeah. In this time, there were a lot of daily papers that were put out, many failing as fast as they came out. Considering that journalism was certainly not what it was or what it is today, a lot of papers, including a few of Horace's early papers, published lottery results, not a lot else.
Cool.
It wasn't like sports or anything to report on.
Still, still more reliable than Fox News, right, guys?
Oh,
So there's a lot of editorial stuff, and that's kind of what he gravitated towards, is editorial stuff.
So it's like your lucky numbers are like 517, yada, yada, yada. And here's my opinion about, like, rutabagas, or like, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, you know, you got to think about, like, what is it? Like, Ben Franklin's just putting out books of just, like, if you put a penny in your pocket today, you'll have two pennies tomorrow. And everyone's like, fuck, this is great. This is, I'm so glad that I bought copies for my whole family.
Yeah. It's like, that Ben Franklin was hilarious.
Yeah.
If you go to bed early, then you get up early the next day. Another solid
Another
gold.
Banger.
Yeah. Fuck Ben Franklin.
Yeah, piece of shit. I think he was dead at this point, by the way.
Certainly.
Yeah, but I mean, you know.
He was one of the older founding fathers.
I know, I'm just saying, like, that's probably the style of the papers. There wasn't a whole lot of...
Very partisan papers. If you think papers today are partisan, back then, even more so.
Even worse than the Clinton News Network?
Nice.
Oh.
Trying to be, you know, bipartisan here, guys.
I understand.
I only get my news from Newsmax. I take my news, crank it to the max. Newsmax, OAN, Fox News, you know, good stuff.
Yeah. Talk about it in Parler.
Yeah, there you go.
By the way, if you're looking for us, you can find us on History Boiz on Parler.
Yeah. I don't even
know how it works.
No, neither
am
I.
Oh, man. Could you imagine us being on Parler?
No.
I think we'd be banned immediately.
Yeah, something. Now, working as a contributing editor for several publications and publishing small literary magazines, they were all financial failures, he finally published the first edition of The New Yorker in 1834. Now, this is not the same New Yorker as the one that exists today.
Okay, I got excited for a second.
Yeah, no.
Now my penis is the small penis.
It's this New Yorker went defunct, and then somebody else was like, oh, there's no paper called The New Yorker, and then remade it. He used it for his own brand of political commentary, and that's where he kind of started getting into politics with newspapers and things like this.
And by editorials, I hope you mean that they were just cartoons with, like, I don't know, politicians dressed like cats, and they got, like, bags of money, and they're scratching each other's backs.
Mm-hmm. That was a different paper, but we'll actually touch on that in this one.
Tyler, you should create a political cartoon, because that was pretty good.
I'll get them. The fat cats in Washington.
They don't know what's coming for them.
Yeah. Now, Horace Greeley was considered to be a bit eccentric in his time. He moved into a boarding house that was supposed to be some sort of utopian commune in the middle of New York City. They had strict dietary restrictions, like no meat, coffee, tea, alcohol, tobacco, or spices of any kind.
Ugh. What the fuck?
It's supposed to be like a clean living, temperance, you only take what you need kind of a deal.
It's like every couple of decades, you know, it's just...
Yeah.
A bunch of people want to get together and smell each other's cabbage farts.
Yeah.
I'm going to need my spices. I'm going to be honest with you guys.
Yeah.
Yeah, come on, man. I need something.
Like, I can do without alcohol or whatever. That's not true. That's a fucking lie, and you guys know it.
Yeah. If they're like, you can either have coriander or beer, you're like, I need my coriander.
Yeah.
Yeah,
<right. laughs> yeah. Turmeric? Come on.
Yeah.
Paprika? Can't even activate. You can't even activate the turmeric without black pepper, so you're going to need two.
I need at least two.
For the inflammation.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Now, this type of commune would preach temperance, feminism, although it's not to be confused with suffrage, like female suffrage. The arc of feminism and suffrage we should probably at least try to cover a little bit on the show, but I'm not going to touch it here. Vegetarianism, socialism, and abolitionism. That's like what they were all about.
Some of those are cool.
Yeah, right?
I mean, vegetarianism is probably the right way to go. I just like meat because I'm a bad person.
I wonder how they went about canceling people back then, because you know that those are the guys that are canceling people. I'm just saying.
Everybody getting canceled these days. You know,
everybody's getting canceled these days. You can't say anything anymore. And I got 15 minutes of fresh material on how I can't say anything anymore.
Speaking of that, just watched Kevin Hart's new special.
Is it called? Yeah, I said
it. Might as well be called... Yeah. It's called, like, not giving a fuck or something.
Of course.
Okay. And he's like, I don't want to get canceled. And you're like, everybody shut the fuck up. No. The only people getting canceled, raped people.
Yeah, so. are horrible people. But it was here that Horace met his future wife, school teacher Mary Young Cheney.
He got a Dick little Cheney. Bit of that granola puss.
The carpet matches the drapes. Dreadlocks.
Not quite. Although, have you seen a picture of Horace Greeley?
I didn't even know who he was.
You did send out photos.
Oh, yeah, you did. Yeah.
Didn't you? He had a neck, literally just a neck.
Oh, yep. Oh, I remember.
You did show us
that's
that.
That's right.
It's
yes.
only on his neck, like so. Your chin goes down, you know, and it's just along the neck. And he grew it out long that it would go over his collar.
Yeah.
It's so weird.
I bet he loved Star Wars. And by that I mean, like most Star Wars fans, hated Star Wars.
So the two were married in 1836, but they actually took no honeymoon. Horace actually opted to go to Washington, D.C. instead to observe Congress in session and then went straight back to New York to get back to work.
So he didn't even take his wife?
No.
Take my wife, please.
He quickly became involved in politics, writing in support of the Whig Party. He actually became good friends and allies with New York publisher and politician, who we mentioned in the Arthur episode, Thurlow Weed.
I remember that guy.
Yeah.
Puff, yeah, baby.
Yeah.
Together with Weed, they helped get William H. Seward elected as New York governor. And later, with this alliance of Seward and Weed, this would happen a little later, but Greeley would actually fill a vacancy in the House of Representatives for 3 months. And it kind of pissed everybody off, because instead of, like, trying to work there, he just kept throwing all the hypocrisies of Congress out. Like, he'd stand and, like, give, like, these speeches about, like, how they're all fucking up and how they all need to, like, do better and shit like that. And everyone's like, can you just get out of here, man? You weren't even elected.
Don't come to me with problems. Come to me with solutions.
Yeah.
So they couldn't deal with the fact that Horace was being pretty rock and roll about this whole situation.
Kind of, I guess.
It's like, fuck you, I see through your ruse, man.
Yeah.
Wake up, sheeple.
Yeah.
Right. He was very much involved in the 1840 election of William Henry Harrison. Horace wrote the political songs for Harrison and Tyler on their ticket in his publication, Log Cabin, which had a far and wide circulation. And you can actually look these songs up on YouTube.
Oh, I bet they're good.
Oh, my God, they are bad. Like, ridiculously bad.
There's no way they are.
Yeah, it's bad.
Did it used to be a practice where people would run in for office and they would come up with songs
for that
purpose?
Yeah.
Because now they just play some fucking dumb rock song that somebody gives a cease and desist for.
Right, you know what I mean? Exactly.
They're on some Springsteen or, you know... They put on the YMCA song, and then I have to be constantly thinking about the fact that I've never had a good meal at a YMCA. I've never had a meal at a YMCA. If there's no lyrics in that song about how, like, there's an overchlorinated pool or some guy's looking in your locker and you're like, how'd you get in there? I put a lock on it. Like, that's not in the song.
I don't think the meals are for you, Tyler.
Yeah, I think the meal's a metaphor. For gay stuff.
I think they like help homeless populations is what they do. So the very next year, Greeley would open his most famous publication, the one that he was actually known for, the New York Tribune.
Ah.
And that's the one that's still around.
Sort of.
God damn it.
Sort of. Horace Greeley was the one to write the famous editorial, Go West, Young Man. You ever heard that?
He
basically is like encouraging people to go west and seek their fortunes in the west because of economic stagnation in the east. And
he's like, I mean, I'm not gonna go, but you totally should.
Yeah.
Do you think that the Pet Shop Boys were inspired to write Go West because of this editorial?
Yes. No, yes, I do.
Tom Waits was.
Yeah. But they actually, both those songs were written because it was due to economic stagnation, and they're like, we gotta get this economy going again. Come on, Pet Shop Boys.
We gotta go west.
And Tom Waits was like, we gotta get this economy going again.
That is a direct quote from Tom Waits, yes. they wrote it.
Tom Waits. Yeah, he wrote it phonetically. I love Tom Waits.
I love Tom Waits. You guys know this.
Yeah, no, Tom Waits is great. It's just too bad that he sounds like he ate a bunch of gravel and washed it down with whiskey.
No,
I feel like that's a good thing. It's like, you know, it's a Tom Waits song.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. You could never heard it in your life, but it's a Tom Waits song.
It's not like, who is this, John Bon Jovi? It's like, no, it's clearly Tom Waits.
Oh my God, can you imagine Tom Waits doing a cover of Living on a Prayer?
I would listen to that.
Or Wanted Dead or Alive.
I would listen to both of those.
Yeah, I would love that.
Now, the paper, as many of his papers, started off as an unprofitable money pit, with Horace sinking more and more of his own money into it than what it was bringing in. Sometimes he even borrowed money from rich financiers.
It's like starting a restaurant.
Yeah, it wasn't going well.
Just wait until he owns a house.
Right. Henry J. Raymond started his storied career off at the New York Tribune as Greeley's chief assistant. And Raymond, he would later go on and found a little paper called the New York Times.
The lying fake news New York Times.
Yeah. But this time it was a Republican paper. So there you go.
This Horace, is before or after the switch?
This is clearly before. Horace wanted the Tribune to have everything. He wanted literature, politics, but most importantly, he wanted it to be a national paper rather than a local paper. And they didn't really have national papers back then.
How are you going to get them everywhere?
Why don't they use the internet?
Express, the railroad.
Some guy falls off a horse and was like, I was hit in the back by engines. And he like falls. He's like, here's your newspaper, sir. It's like, that's worth it. You know?
Well, and they drop them off at towns and you buy them at general stores and things like that.
Okay.
There's, well, you know, like in Red Dead, the town crier kid.
Mm-hmm.
And he comes out and he goes, extry, extry. Yeah, read all about it.
Yeah,
it's like, yeah, they robbed a bank. He mentions missions he already did.
Yeah, it's kind of exactly. Cool. Yeah.
Oh, so like Newsies.
Yeah.
Flipping around.
Yeah. Okay. You know, Newsies, flipping around.
Flipping around.
Well, great gymnasts, those Newsies.
Yeah.
I'm thinking of Spider-Man. My bad.
There you go. Mm. The Tribune would be one of the first papers to have a full-time correspondent in Washington, D.C. to report on the goings-on of the government.
No shit.
He even hired Karl Marx as a foreign correspondent that wrote so many articles for the New York Tribune.
He's like, Karl Marx, things aren't going so good over here, and the reason why is because the means of production aren't controlled by the proletariat. And like, let me tell you, and it just turns into the Communist Manifesto. Like every time he's like giving us his like foreign correspondence, it's like, it's sunny over here, but no communism yet, and there should be communism, and let me tell you why.
Yeah, we're all Republicans here. How about you?
Yeah.
That's what would happen in this time.
Oh my God.
Horace Greeley actually, he conducted the first interview ever with Brigham Young. He actually went all the way to Salt Lake City to do that.
The Mormon guy.
Yeah, the Mormon leader. We'll do a whole episode on Brigham Young.
I really like how that's an interesting group of people to keep. Karl Marx and Brigham Young.
Yeah. Right. He even said, like, if you don't agree totally with Karl Marx, he has ideas to say, and you need to listen to them. You know what
sure,
I mean? He was
sure.
kind of like an intellectual idealist, basically.
Well, and also, like, back then it was so hard to get an interview with Brigham Young because you had to take a box and prop it up with a stick and put a 12-year-old girl underneath it.
Oh, that was perfect.
Yeah, fuck that guy. He was a really bad person.
Yeah, he was horrible.
Yeah, he was. Price for a yearly subscription of the New York Tribune was $2 Oof, a year.
For a year?
Yeah.
$2?
I think it's around, I think it's around $15 for a whole year.
What am I, made of money?
Yeah. Fuck, dude. Like, last year I got a year subscription of the New York Times for Liz, and it was $100 $150,
yeah.
I want to say?
Yeah.
$2 for a year.
$2 for a year.
Well, I mean,
which, again, $15
wasn't necessarily
then, something like that.
Worth
at the time,
$2
I would say it would have been highway robbery if there were highways yet.
I think there are.
There you go.
Well, there were, but they just, you know.
Not really.
Dirt. You can't have highways without highwaymen.
Well, yeah. They got like a.
This is true.
They got like a boot, you know, they got like a boot with like a derringer in it. I don't know, like maybe a mask.
Yeah, those three things.
They got those things.
Boom, highwaymen.
Yeah.
Yeah. Shaking people down or trying to just get to the next city to make a life for themselves.
They're like, I'm gonna knock over this newspaper, you know, carriage and stay informed and keep my friends informed by sharing with them.
There you go.
Yeah. It's a noble pursuit.
Horace was always a loud voice in the North for abolition. And the civil liberty for all men, and men being key there. Not a lot of people were for women's suffrage just yet.
So
and,
sort
yeah,
of
was
like,
for,
yeah, there were
was
like,
for male suffrage, you know, for black male suffrage.
Hmm.
He opposed any slave state joining the Union because back then, you know, it could switch, you know, the way the country voted and it could really fuck shit up. Mm-hmm. So he opposed all those slave states that were going to join the Union. He railed against the federal and state government corruption, which was rampant during this time.
You don't say.
Good thing that's over.
Yeah, it was pretty bad during this era. It's kind of, this era is sort of known for its corruption.
Hmm.
Gotta drain that swamp.
Yeah. But soon, Greeley's New York Tribune was the most read publication in circulation, second only to the Bible.
Mm. Oh, fucking shit.
Yeah, it was the most. Horace Greeley was the most read man in America. He was a celebrity. Absolutely, he was. So, yeah, he definitely had some pull with the American people. He could definitely sway opinion. So, Horace Greeley wrote editorials and opinions on nearly every political issue. And this actually kind of came back to bite him later when he did eventually run for president. Because the thing is like, you know, politicians, they don't like to answer questions, right? Like, they don't like to go, are you for this or are you not for that? Well, with Greeley, he's written about literally every political issue on the spectrum, and he has written opinions on everything.
Right.
So, it was already there. People definitely knew where he stood, which was sort of a good thing, and it was great for selling papers, but it hurt him when he ran, what I mean?
And he had some controversial opinions.
He kind of did, honestly.
One of them was his favorite sexual position being girl on top.
Yeah. Which was very progressive for the time.
There was only two ways beforehand that people adopted and thought were okay, and that was normal and missionary.
What's normal?
What's normal?
Doggy.
I always called missionary original recipe.
Yeah, there you go.
From Tyler. Plain. That's a Tyler joke.
Especially considering that hindsight is 2020, he wrote a lot of things that are contradictory to look at now. But this happens a lot today as well. So, one day he would write this whole editorial that was, against this one thing, and then things would happen, and then he'd sort of have a changed mind about it, right?
Right. I can't wait till this podcast is listened to, a long time from now, and people are like, man, that Chris Gasher was an idiot.
You run for president?
No.
He would consider himself more radical than Lincoln, although he supported him as sort of a second choice after his friend William Seward. So, Seward was going for the nomination. Lincoln got it because he was a little bit more moderate, and he was kind of a dark horse candidate, Lincoln was, famously. Mm-hmm. And actually, Lincoln gave Seward a cabinet position to make sure he couldn't actually run against him when he eventually did go for re-election.
Solid move.
Smooth move.
Very, very much so.
How do you go up against Lincoln, man? He comes out and he says, four-score log cabin.
Yeah.
Need I say more? Also,
He came out of nowhere.
I mean, in retrospect.
He was 9 feet tall.
He fixed racism. He ended it.
Yeah.
Lincoln did, from my understanding. And it never existed again.
And Lincoln's brand of republicanism was a particular kind. And Horace Greeley was actually the man who coined the name Republican. He was the man that actually called the Republican Party the Republican Party.
Mm.
Huh.
So there you go. That's where the name comes from.
But when Lincoln was a Republican, were the values of the party, fiscal conservatism, small government?
We're going to get there. We're actually going to talk about that. Okay. We're going to talk about how we'll talk about taxes and tariffs.
Ooh.
And about how those two things are opposite
taxes,
now.
Taxes and tariffs are super interesting, like in the first Star Wars movie.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know.
Episode 1.
Well, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail about it. But you should know about it because that is where it shifts.
Yeah, you should know about it because it's in Star Wars.
Yeah. Exactly.
What are the stakes of your space opera? They're blockading the primary trade route. How are these people supposed to get dietary supplements?
Yeah. Spices.
Spices.
Space blood.
And not dew spices, just regular ones, turmeric, and then black pepper to activate it.
It's really all it was.
Horace Greeley's like, nuh-uh.
How's Naboo going to get its fucking turmeric and black pepper?
Yeah.
So did you guys notice in episode 1 that the blockade is only on one side of the entire planet?
Yeah.
Guys.
Even watching Mandalorian.
It's 360s. You can go on the opposite side.
And I love Mandalorian. I'm just saying, I'm pretty sure they don't understand how space works at all.
Yeah. I mean, it's run by Disney execs. What do you expect?
Greeley did support Lincoln, but Greeley liked to put pressure on Lincoln to be more radical than he actually was. When war broke out, Greeley initially wanted the South to basically fuck off. If they want to secede, let them. Let them. We'll abolish slavery here. They can go fuck themselves. Why not?
Right.
He wanted abolition more than to keep the Union together. And this is something that basically he and Lincoln disagreed on. And Horace wrote a letter addressed to Lincoln that was printed in the Tribune that basically asked Lincoln to hold up. He's basically asking him what the holdup was on abolition. Mm-hmm. And he's like, hey, you promised to do this, now do it. You know what I mean? Legal, you know, you have to make slavery illegal. You have to do all of these things. How come you're not doing it? You need to, you know, make good on your promises. And he also said that the South can go fuck themselves, basically.
Right.
Anyway, this was called the Prayer for 20 Millions, is what this letter was called. So Lincoln artfully and skillfully responded with this now very famous letter that was printed in a competing paper, which is fantastic.
Oh, dear.
So this is addressed directly to Horace Greeley. This is fantastic. This is a great letter. August 22nd, 1862. Honorable Horace Greeley. Dear sir, I have just read yours of the 19th. He's talking about the letter. Addressed to myself through the New York Tribune. If there be in it any statements or assumptions of fact which I may not know to be erroneous, I do not now or here controvert them. If there be in it any inferences which I may believe to be falsely drawn, I do not now and here argue against them. So basically being like, look, man, I'm not going to fucking argue with you, okay? Mm-hmm. I'm going to tell you this right here and now, you know. And yeah, listen to the choice of words that he uses, because we already know basically what happens. If there be perceptible in it an impatient and dictatorial tone, I waive it in deference to an old friend whose heart I have always supposed to be right. As to the policy I, quote, seem to be pursuing, as you say, I have not meant to leave anyone in doubt. I would save the Union. I would save it in the shortest way under the Constitution. The sooner the national authority can be restored, the nearer the Union will be the Union as it was. If there be those who would not save the Union, unless they could at the same time save slavery, I do not agree with them. If there would be those who would not save the Union, unless they could at the same time destroy slavery, I do not agree with them. My paramount object in this struggle is to save the Union, and is not either to save or to destroy slavery. If I could save the Union without freeing any slave, I would do it. And if I could save it by freeing all the slaves, I would do it. And if I could save it by freeing some and leaving others alone, I would also do that. What I do about slavery and the colored race, I do because I believe it helps to save the Union. And what I forbear because I do not believe it would help save the Union. I shall do less whenever I shall believe what I'm doing hurts the cause, and I shall do more whenever I shall believe doing more will help the cause. I shall try to correct errors when shown to be errors, and I shall adopt new visions so fast as they shall appear to be true views. I have here stated my purpose according to my view of official duty, and I intend no modification of my oft-expressed personal wish that all men everywhere could be free. Yours, A. Lincoln.
Damn!
Yeah.
I mean, it could have been... So, it was just A. Lincoln. It could have been any of them.
Any Lincoln. But what Greeley and the rest of the nation didn't know as they read this letter is that sitting on Abraham Lincoln's desk as he wrote this was a draft of the Emancipation Proclamation that he was going to sign into law.
So do you think, I mean, based off what he's saying, like, essentially saving the unions first, freeing the slaves is good, but...
Yeah, is next.
It's secondary, essentially, yes, to that idea. So do you feel that he views that abolition is the key to saving the Union?
Yes, and because he's letting his action after this letter comes out speak for what his actual beliefs are.
Yeah, that's kind of
it's masterful.
Yeah, it's kind of a ballsy move, being like, I got this shit on my desk. I ain't gonna tell you about it yet.
Yeah, exactly.
Just wait till I drop my next mixtape.
Yeah,
called the Emancipation Proclamation.
Mixtape.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Basically, you're right. It's essentially his own fucking mixtape, but, like, not only was that well-written and the Emancipation Proclamation, but the, I believe it's called the Lysom Address, or Lysom Address. Fuck, talk about, like, some chilling, beautiful writing that he does.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. He was a very gifted writer and storyteller and everything. He liked to tell jokes a lot.
Lincoln?
Yeah.
Cool.
Well, Greeley was pretty much a thorn in the side of any politician that didn't 100% agree with him on every issue.
Like Bernie Sanders.
Yeah, he would hound them at every turn, including Andrew Johnson, whom he supported the impeachment and removal of, although the removal actually never happened. He even urged that the Union be nice to the surrendering Confederates and wanted to prove that there needed to be a sense of humanity and forgiveness towards the Confederates, which was a very controversial opinion at the time.
Don't worry, guys. You guys are going to have a movie that people think is way better than it is. It's going to be based on a book that's way better than people say, or that's way worse than people say it is, but for some reason it's a classic. You guys want some statues? You guys can have some statues. It won't be a problem like 100 years from now. So, yeah, have the
that's
statues.
That's a story for a different day. The statues are a story for a different day. That was a 20th century thing. Yeah, so there were two ideas in the Republican camp, basically, that we just fought a war against the Confederacy, and because we're successful, we have to make them do what the fuck we want them to do. You know, we fought this war for a reason. And then there was others that were like, look, we beat them, we burn their city to the goddamn ground, you know, a couple of them, let them just go back to being states. And it's like, well, that doesn't fix anything. You know?
Right.
You're going to promise? And they're like, eh. You know?
It's the equivalent of getting spanked by dad.
Yeah, a little bit. Only there was a war, you know, so it's after a war.
Yeah, exactly.
Horace went so far as to post bail for Jefferson Davis, the Confederate president. He got a bunch of money together, like, and not a small amount of change. Like, it was a lot of money. And they posted it, and he promptly fled the country to avoid a trial.
Regular Kyle Rittenhouse.
Yeah, there you go.
I believe Kyle Rittenhouse fled to a Walmart. they still have a problem.
Yeah. So Horace Greeley believed that the only way to get the South back into the Union peacefully was to have a lenient Reconstruction policy, but he also wanted full autonomy for black citizens. He's like, promise that you'll treat them equally and we'll all be hunky-dory. And it's like, Horace, that's not going to fucking work. You know? They're not just going to go, okay. You know?
You see, I think the only way that Horace would have been able to do that, you know, for everyone to get along hunky-dory is he was on the monitor and just threatened everybody who wouldn't get in line.
Right.
And would just get fucking blown up from the monitor.
Right.
I like the scenario where he's like, promise you guys are gonna be nice to all these black guys and girls because they're my friends. He's like, all right, I told them all. They all said that they promised that they're gonna be nice to him. And then like 15 minutes later, come on, guys, you promised.
I mean, it's not far off, honestly, because there was a 10% policy. Whereas if you were 10%, you know, you accepted the Constitution and all the new amendments that they put through, 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendment, then you could come back and you said, yeah, I'm part of the United States, you know, again.
Mm-hmm.
You could come back. 10% policy. And a lot of states, like, kind of got on it, but a few states were slower than others.
Yeah.
That was like, because of the inbreeding.
Yeah. Well, the same with, like, the end of segregation.
Right.
Where it's, like, technically, like, I think it was 1956 where it was officially over, but, right. You know, things take a minute.
Yeah.
And yeah, this view was very much against, like, the Republican establishment political views at the time. He actually ran unsuccessfully for Congress in 1866 as he started to side more and more with the radical Republicans. And there
the radical right.
Radical, the radical Republicans were a little different. We'll see. Like, these parts of the Republican Party will pop up and then just disappear. And pop up and disappear.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of what marks this time. So during the Grant years, Greeley separated more and more with the candidate he once half-heartedly supported. So he joined with the Liberal Republican Party that formed to oppose Grant and the rampant corruption in the Grant presidency. Yeah, it was basically, the two things were basically anti-Grant and light Reconstruction policy. Those are their two things.
Mm-hmm.
So he was Antigra.
Ah, that's good.
Thank you. I'm here all night. Tip your bartenders.
Feel bad being Grant, and everyone's anti you, you know?
Well, he's definitely going to get the nomination. I mean, he won easily the first time he was elected. He's going to win, or he's going to get the nomination again.
When he wins, is he going to be like, wish granted?
He actually was a very shy person, not a good public speaker at all. He was not very witty at all either.
No,
he was an alcoholic.
Oh, poor guy.
So in 1871, Greeley was nominated as the candidate for the Liberal Republican Party, along with Missouri Governor Benjamin Gratz Brown as his running mate. And it started off well, because Greeley was a famous household name. And the Democratic Party, they basically looked at Greeley's soft policy towards the South, you know, wanting to end the military occupation and general amnesty towards some of the old Confederates. And of course, he was anti-Grant, and they knew they weren't going to win any sort of election being Democrats. So what they did is they actually never picked a candidate. They actually opted to put all their support behind Greeley.
Well, there you go.
Mm.
So it's a Republican against Liberal Republican.
Interesting.
There is no Democrat candidate. There was guys that were like, I'm a Democrat and I'm running. And they're like, yeah, whatever.
Fuck you.
Yeah.
Like, we're with Greeley and we're all down with anti-Grant's big ol' house of fun.
God damn it.
But it was all downhill from there. That was like the best it looked, honestly, for Greeley. He was trashed in a competing newspaper, Harper's Weekly, by the famed political cartoonist and satirist Thomas Nast.
Oh, it's so nasty.
So, Thomas. Tyler, when you talked earlier about like the fat, you know, the cartoons about like the fat cats and stuff like that, that was Thomas Nast that drew those.
Thomas Nast.
Yeah.
Not Thomas Nast. Nash.
Yeah. No, not me.
Nast. Thomas. Hey. You're like, I'm sick of people thinking I'm, you know, a 19th century political satirist.
He railed against Greeley's waffling on opinions on the South, and he was harsh towards his soft Reconstruction policy. He actually depicted Greeley shaking hands with the ghost of John Wilkes Booth over the grave of Abraham Lincoln.
Oh,
that's so hard.
That's awesome.
Yeah, that's oof. You know,
that cuts deep. That's some solid editorial cartooning.
Oh yeah.
I bet you there was like one where there was an old oak tree and it said Horace Greeley under it, and then it's waving back and forth in the wind, and then there's two cats in suits with monocles saying, "Any way the wind blows, do you understand what I'm saying, my man?" And that's how they got him.
I'm telling you, Tyler, you got to become a political
Greeley
cartoonist.
Read it, and he slammed his fist on the table, and he's like, "You get me that Nast."
It's like the opening of Citizen Kane, where like the guy keeps reading the articles and like pulling the paper down and like scold, like staring and scolding into the camera.
Yeah.
Dang it!
You call this satire? I call it nasty.
Nice, and that's where the word came from.
Yeah. Thomas Nast is going to pop up a lot in episodes we do. So cool. There you go.
Is that because he has almost the same name as you?
No, it's because he was very famous during this era.
I didn't actually think that was the reason. Also, people who know you as Jerry are very confused right now.
They are very confused. I am both Tom and Jerry, guys. What do you think of that?
He did some things he's not very proud of, and he's had to go under an alias on account of mistakes that he's made early on in his career. So, yeah. But we believe in second chances here on
back when he ran for mayor of Emmett, Idaho.
Yeah. Oh, it was so I was run out of town on a rail.
You were too far right for them.
Old timey ways.
Pump harder, me.
But there was another problem with Greeley's campaign, though. His running mate, Benjamin Gratz Brown, was a raging alcoholic.
Nice. One of us.
He got trashed and gave an incoherent political speech at Yale. And he also puked that night, like in front of everybody.
During the speech,
again,
or
it
just...
sounds like us. It sounds like us at one of the bars. It sounds like me at a bar.
That's badass, and it's a story I would tell everyone if I did that. I was like, oh, I went up and I fucking gave that speech blackout drunk and puked in front of everybody. It was hilarious.
It just, I can't wait for us to be able to do live shows when this whole COVID thing's over. That's pretty much, that's what immediately
we're all just like blackout drunk, like.
Puking on the stage.
Yeah, it's like a replacement show.
Get a fucking mop bucket.
Yeah.
Just have a bunch of them ready.
Yeah. he said it must have been something I ate, is what he would say.
Yeah,
it must have been something I ate.
I've also used that excuse before. Yeah.
What the heck was in that whiskey?
I think there was alcohol in that whiskey. Yeah. I've been poisoned by my constituents.
There was also rumors that he was so shit-faced that he was seen at a party buttering a watermelon.
That actually sounds delicious.
I've done weird shit.
I don't know if that's like an acquired taste or if he actually was so shit-faced that he was doing that.
I mean, I cut a traffic cone in half with a box knife wearing an ill-fitting suit, so.
This is true.
And it was also while he was a presidential front runner. So
in 2008, I was right behind Obama.
Yeah, he turned out to be a total embarrassment for Greeley. And this was actually the same election that Victoria Woodhull, the first woman to ever run for president, ran, as well as Frederick Douglass, the first black man to run for the vice presidency. They ran on the same ticket.
Right.
Yeah.
And so basically, it's not illegal for her to run. It's illegal for her to vote.
I know. It's so weird. Like,
and my understanding was like Victoria Woodhull, she was doing that kind of like not just making a farce out of it, just being like, well, it was more along the lines of like, look at how fucking absurd this is. I can't vote, but I can run as president.
Yeah. It's like
it was
protest
a political
run.
Statement.
Like, yeah.
Yeah. She got arrested for publishing an obscene newspaper the day before election day.
Was it called Big Naturals?
No, it was talking about women's suffrage. It's obscene.
It's obscene.
Tossed her in jail.
Women's rights. Women should vote. And they're like, ew.
Yeah.
We don't. Women are allowed to run for president, but not have rights.
No. Susan B. Anthony was also arrested during this election for trying to vote. And she was later fined $100, which is a lot of money back then.
That's right. I mean, that wouldn't it technically be voter fraud since it was illegal?
Yeah.
Somebody's not a registered voter?
Yeah, she was. That's what she was.
I'm not saying it's right.
Yeah.
I'm just saying.
Yep.
So
you could get 50 subscriptions to the newspaper with that fine.
I would like 50.
Like a lot more than that.
I have a real question to ask. And this may sound obscene, but I genuinely am curious. Do you think that there was like a women's suffrage kink that some people had? Like they thought that was like the most like kinkiest, sexy thing.
They're going to get out there and they're going to vote. They're going to vote so good.
They're going to show off their calves.
I doubt it.
Zach, absolutely yes.
They're going to grab that lever with both hands
and
they're going to pull Lincoln.
Yeah.
No.
You know, no. You know, there was, like, politicians at the time who were super against women voting, who they would be like, oh, pretend to vote now, yeah, vote with my dick.
Jesus. You can always point out those guys because they were like,
oh, no,
they're perverts.
What if I was the voting machine and the lever was my penis?
Yeah.
And that's only women could come into the voting station. And they're like, and
I'm just saying the hypocrisy.
It's very progressive.
The hypocrisy of these politicians is, that's all I'm pointing out. I'm not trying to make a joke about women.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to get canceled.
Yeah.
I'm kidding. I'm making fun of people who
I'm making a joke about how dudes are weird, gross, horny monsters, and anything that they could turn into a kink, they will.
Yeah. No, yeah. I bet there were people who were like
Rule 34 basically.
I'm with Zach. That's real. I guarantee it.
I don't know if there was a lot of suffragettes that were into that.
No!
I'll tell you that
it probably wasn't. It was probably one of those, like, in modern terms, one of those, like, you know, Republican board housewives who's cheating on their husband with the senator and being like, "Yeah, I'm voting. Look at me vote with your dick." That's what it was. Nobody was supporting of it in that those circles. They're all a bunch of hypocrites. Fuck them all. And their perversions.
Let me get into your ballot box, baby.
Yeah.
Jesus.
It's where the word box comes from.
Something about a caucus.
So the week before Election Day, however, Horace's wife, Mary, passed away.
That sucks.
And he plunged into despair and cut off his whole campaign. On top of that, when he returned to the Tribune, there was a plot to remove him from his own paper. And so Horace suffered from insomnia and was admitted to the, I don't know how to really pronounce this, somebody's going to correct me on this, Chowat House or Chowate House?
Chow.
I don't know.
I thought you were going to be like, I'm going to get murdered. I don't know if I'm going to pronounce this right. Mental hospital.
It was a private small mental hospital. Yes, it was.
Arkham.
Dr. George Chowate, or however the hell it's pronounced, ran the place. But his condition worsened, and he eventually passed away before the electoral votes could be counted. He died before the election was over with, which is insane. Jesus.
Wow.
Yeah,
what if he won?
Well, right. I mean, we wouldn't know. You
well,
know,
it's
we wouldn't
like
know
when
what to do.
Fucking Trump got COVID, we were kind of like,
right.
Is he going to survive to the election?
Yeah.
They pumped him up on Regeneron.
Yeah. Now, Grant won by a landslide, so there's no real mystery as to who won. But Greeley's paltry 66 electoral votes to Grant's 286. Now, he only needed 177 back then to win. That was a landslide. He got slaughtered in that election.
He was dead, so.
Yeah. Well, I mean, he didn't die before the election. He died before the votes could be counted.
Oh, so this was these votes for Grant. These were the votes from before he died. It wasn't like a the Electoral College like revoted or anything. This was from before. Wow.
But yeah, between Election Day and all the votes being totally counted, he died.
I think he died on purpose to avoid the embarrassment.
Yeah.
That's my hot take.
From lead poisoning, if you know what I mean.
No.
A lead pipe.
Biden got more votes than Grant, just putting that out there.
But it was decided that the votes would be split to some third-party candidates, Thomas Hendricks, Benjamin Gratz Brown, the running mate. Some people, I think there was one elector that was like, "No, I still vote for Greeley." And they're like, "Okay, whatever, shut up, man." And like,
oh, so they
moved on.
When they revoted, they just kind of...
Well, they just split them up between who was left, basically.
They didn't... Did they get to choose? Like, did some of them pick Grant, or?
Some of them made sure, they didn't pick Grant, but some of them made sure that they steered their electoral vote towards somebody else. You know what I mean? That's how they were kind of divided. Otherwise, they were divided pretty evenly. There was a couple of people that kind of raised a stink about it. But Grant, 286, I mean, Jesus.
They're like,
Christ,
he got 286, it doesn't fucking matter.
Yeah. There's people that, like, wanted their vote to be on record, which I totally get. So,
and now we've all forgotten about it.
Yeah.
Until now.
Way to go, protest vote. Nobody cares after the fact.
Yeah.
It's like they're going to make a movie about me someday.
I'm the one guy who used his electoral vote as a protest against Ulysses S. Grant. Yeah. I'm going to be a hero in this country.
I simply can't vote Grant.
Nice.
It's like the people who voted for Jill Stein in 2016. Sure. Heroes. All of them.
Yep.
Right. See, maybe this is why they should have started to implement preferential voting. But, I mean, that's just me.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. This is definitely a time of growing pains in American history.
Oh, you mean right now?
Yeah, sure, too.
No, this is the end.
This is Destros.
Yeah. This is... let me continue.
The great experience experiment that was the U.S. is coming to an end.
Yeah, we're one tweet away from all-out civil war.
Yeah.
All you've got to do is say, Proud Boys, start shooting people. And they're like, all right, well, fuck, dude. Like, he told us to.
Yeah. Yes, sir, Mr. President. So Horace Greeley was buried in Brooklyn's Greenwood Cemetery, and his funeral was attended by many, including his opponent, Ulysses S. Grant.
Huh. Everyone I'm laughing because of, like, Trump not going to, like, McCain's
funeral.
I think he wasn't invited. Isn't that correct?
Yeah, something like that.
McCain was like, I don't want that guy at my funeral. And I don't want Trump at my funeral.
I like how we just got a civil war here, and people are way more decent about it, less petty about it back then. out of a war.
Grant was super petty about it. He was like, I feel like it was just yesterday I won that election against him, you know? You guys remember that? And so full of energy, and then I won the election, and I don't want to say that it's the loss is what killed him, but
he's like the last time I met Greeley, I was just beating his ass in the election. And, it really meant a lot to me, and I'm always going to remember that about how badly I defeated him. Like, sir, this is a eulogy. This is completely inappropriate.
But
seriously, right. I think the political pettiness has hit a fever pitch with Donald Trump. So, I don't think anybody has been as bad as him in this country.
Certainly not.
Not yet.
Now, despite the hate being thrown at him during his life, especially during the 1872 campaign, a lot of people wrote and published warm letters in memoriam about Greeley, including Harriet Beecher Stowe and other, like, a lot of people wrote about how, you know, they're like, you don't have to agree with that guy, but the shit that dude believed in, he believed in till the end. You know what I mean? He had integrity. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Is that what people are going to think about Alex Jones?
He believed it
to the very end.
That man is a fear-mongering hack.
People
also doesn't actually
people who know him
shit
personally believe he doesn't actually. And he brought that up during fucking his divorce trial.
He's a character.
He's a fucking piece of shit. Fuck that guy.
He's like, I'm like if Stephen Colbert was dangerous and not funny.
Well, it's like he believes what he says when it benefits him and doesn't when it doesn't benefit him. He doesn't fucking stand for anything.
I didn't know we were going to be talking about the Joe Rogan experience on here.
I
was like, we aren't talking about chimpanzees ripping faces off, but we can if you'd like.
If we could.
You think
it gets us listeners.
So you're telling me that a race war is a super good idea? That's crazy, man.
He's just like, DMT?
He lets... Anyway.
Anyway. I digress. Joe Rogan.
The liberal Republicans dissolved after this, with a lot of them joining the Democratic Party. However, if Grant's first term was marred by corruption, his second term was much worse.
They loved corruption back then.
Oh, yeah. The biggest one Grant's going to deal with is the Credit Mobilier scandal, where all of these, like, he wasn't actually a super corrupt guy, but his cabinet was, and they're all friends of his.
But he picked his cabinet.
He picked his own cabinet, and they're all friends of his. They basically got all these kickbacks from these railroad companies to make favorable legislation so they could keep, like, you know, doing what they were doing.
That's old-timey hilarious.
A guy that makes $4,000 a year has like $2 million in the bank. And it's like, what the fuck?
Guys, you guys promised!
Yeah, yeah.
He really got in there and drained the swamp, didn't he?
Yeah. This is the swamp. Yeah. You know what I mean?
They needed money so they could put like really expensive brandy into like crystal snifters, and then they have like a little table with all their little snifters on it. And whenever they have a meeting, they go in and they grab one, they pour it in a glass, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Rich alcoholism.
So at the tail end of his presidency, Grant's popularity was waning, but he wasn't up for re-election. Or at least people told him, dude, you shouldn't run for a third term, even though like there was talks of it, you know, in our Garfield episode of like Roscoe Conkling trying to,
trying to get him to go again.
Right. Yeah. And they got close during that one.
Well, wasn't he like, I'm all about Ulysses S. Grant, and then like danced on a table and ate a lemon and everyone was like, yeah.
Yeah. Pretty much.
Yeah.
Yeah. So meanwhile, now the Civil War may have ended, but that didn't mean there was a stop to hostilities. Now, although male suffrage was granted to black Americans, it came with heavy caveats in the South. Something called the Black Codes were introduced, which was an anti-vagrancy act, is what they called it. But what it basically said was that it was perfectly legal for any white person to press an unemployed black person into any job they saw fit for extremely low wages.
Jesus.
Which is basically slavery by another name.
Right.
It's slavery. Yeah.
Well, it's like, yeah, there's so many laws that were like, oh, it's this, but it was specifically targeted. And laws that still exist in this country, they're specifically targeted to punish African Americans.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, and it should have been a dead giveaway because the original name for the Black Codes was like, let's just say it's way worse. It's way worse.
Yeah. Right.
They actually toned it down.
The Jim Crow codes.
This is before that, but...
I know that's not the word you were alluding to.
Tyler. So white supremacist groups started forming all over the South, comprising of ex-Confederate soldiers, like the Red Shirts, the White League, Ku Klux Klan.
Well, fuck them.
Yeah, this is when they formed. And groups like these attacked black schools, churches, and communities. But they saved their most frothing rage for the most offensive thing they could think of. What the Black Codes didn't really cover, and that was black landowners and business owners. And they're like, oh, they have land and businesses? Oh, no. You know, that was the most offensive thing they could think of.
Yeah.
Jesus.
Yeah, well, it's like, I mean, I know it was way later, but the Tulsa massacre.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was kind of the same thing. It's like we can't have them successful the way we're supposed to be successful. That's what the fucking problem is.
Yeah. And Reconstruction was supposed to be doing this.
I'm starting to feel
that's the whole aim of Reconstruction.
I'm starting to feel like that whole Reconstruction thing, they kind of botched it.
Well, we'll definitely see the botching of Reconstruction in this episode. Now, these armed racist thugs would bully and threaten people, usually black people, at voting places and voting polls, demanding that they vote the way they wanted. And they burned black-owned homes and establishments and raped and murdered anyone that stood in their way. And their violent propaganda and rhetoric, along with their intimidation tactics, gained them a terrorist organization status in the eyes of the federal government, and rightly so.
Yeah.
States that were still under military occupation during Reconstruction during this time declared martial law against these types of terrorist groups, much like what happened after 9/11. You know, anyone suspected of being a part of this group could be arrested.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
sure.
We're going to get them in their caves. We're going to get in those caves and we're going to bust their bunkers. Let's get them, boys. Got on a stallion and yeehaw.
Yeah.
Right.
George W.
Accomplished.
With a polarized and literally and figuratively divided country along the Mason-Dixon line, as it was called, rising tensions in the United States were coming to a head in 1876. With the future Reconstruction uncertain and the rampant corruption in the Republican Party, the Democratic Party totally in ruins and fractured. Many thought that another civil war could start again. With the war still fresh in everyone's minds, and the Republicans, you know, they couldn't bear the thought of a Democratic president unceremoniously ending the military occupation in the South, effectively handing the reins of the South back over to the ex-Confederates that they had just gotten done, you know, they just got done fighting a war against.
But look on the bright side. There was a handful of, like, one-legged, morphine-addicted, you know, veterans who are like, another civil war, that means more morphine. Yum, 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 yum. And so...
Always a silver lining.
Yeah, always a silver lining.
A bottle of whiskey and a saw. Is more like
I was about to slam my hand in a car door. Thank God for this war coming back around.
And the Democrats argued that it was a states' rights issue, and they should, under the Articles of the Constitution, govern themselves.
I like how people are, you know, some critics of us have said the switch between Republicans and Democrats never happened.
Yeah.
Despite Democrats fighting for states' rights.
Well, and it goes further than this, too, but this is when the fracture begins, really. In 1876... that was the country's centennial, and a fifth of the population flocked to Philadelphia to see the exposition. It was the 100th birthday party of America, basically.
Ah, this centennial.
Yeah, you got to throw a party.
Yeah, I got it.
Yeah.
It's like the bicentennial.
Yeah. Alexander Graham Bell's telephone was there. Heinz Ketchup was there.
Cool.
The first typewriter, the Remington No. 1, was there. The kudzu plant to control erosion was there, and a lot of other stuff was displayed.
When you were naming it, you're like, Alexander Graham's telephone was there, and I just imagined a telephone, like, waving at people walking down the red carpet, and Heinz Ketchup was there, a bottle of ketchup with arms and legs. Like, this seems right.
Yeah. The story of this expo is actually really interesting, too. They actually put he was late. Alexander Graham Bell was late, and he wasn't really planning on going.
He should
have.
They kind of put him in the back corner, and not a lot of people were seeing it.
He should have called ahead, you know,
on the telephone. He's like, ahoy, ahoy, Alexander Graham Bell back here. Meanwhile, the guy who he beat out on the patent, you know, the other telephone guy, he was moving on to new inventions, like a new way to make a noose.
There was Michael Phone.
Michael Phone.
I thought it was Nick Nokia, but I like the microphone.
He's down
there. Nick Nokia is a Greek guy who sells, like, cell phones out of the back of, like, a U-Haul.
He's like, you want a cell phone?
Nick Nokia.
You don't want a cell phone? This is bullshit. This is bullshit. It's my Greek accent.
It's bullshit, man.
This is bullshit.
I don't even know if that's a good...
It's not accurate, but I like enunciating the wrong word. That makes you sound foreign.
Yeah. Now, the only way the Democrats could have any chance of winning was to pick a New York Democrat for their candidate that also wanted to end Reconstruction, much like how Greeley imagined it. So they chose a popular New York governor, Samuel Tilden, and he had solidified his name in taking down an old colleague and corrupt party boss, William Boss Tweed, of the New York Tammany Hall Democratic Political Machine.
What?
Which is a story for another day. I really want to do Boss Tweed.
We've been talking about doing that episode for a while.
Yeah.
By the way, looking at this picture of Samuel Tilden, he looks like a fucking nerd. I want to wring his throat. You know who he looks like? He looks like, Tyler, you've seen Cobra Kai.
Yeah.
Hawk before he becomes Hawk.
When he's a little crybaby, because he has a hair lip and everyone makes fun of him. He's like, I should become an inventor and invent some new nooses, if you know what I mean.
But he flipped the script, Tyler, and became one of my favorite characters, and kind of a huge piece of shit, and I love it.
He's become a total piece of shit. I'm all about that Supreme Court.
Cobra Kai, Netflix, everybody watch it.
Now, although Tilden may have worked with Boss Tweed in the past, he was the one responsible for his ultimate political demise. And his election to governor was sort of a given for that. It really made him kind of a hero in New York for that. reason. Samuel Tilden was a quiet, intelligent man by all accounts. His family were actually makers of something called Tilden's Extract. Ooh. There was a patented medicine derived from cannabis.
Oh!
I thought it was going to be semen. I thought it was going to be semen.
You think everything's going to be semen. But this is the one thing better than semen. Cannabis. Ah.
So Sam Tilden helped form the anti-slavery wing of the Democratic Party in New York called the Barn Burners.
We're going to burn them barns.
Why is it called that? Is it because...
they were really gassy, and it was like, they were just hot, nasty farts, and they all had them. Once again, a lot of people eating cabbage.
We got a lot of slaves living in barns. We're going to burn those barns, but free the slaves first, because that would be murder.
Yeah. We're the barn burners.
Samuel Tilden wasn't a political, like, public dynamo, nor was he a gifted orator. But he was definitely a safe choice. He was actually a lifelong bachelor. He never married. Thomas Nast actually depicted him in a dress, heavily implying that he was a homosexual. But many biographers since have hypothesized that maybe he was actually asexual, showing no sexual interest in any sex.
Honestly, it's probably more likely.
And other historians have argued that he just liked smashing tons of strange, and so he never married.
Maybe. Yeah, he never settled down.
Realistically, he was probably asexual.
Yeah, his interest was in politics, and really nothing else.
He was sexually aroused from C-SPAN.
Yeah, there you go.
He was sexually aroused by the letter A. That's why he got good grades.
He's like, I gotta pass this test or else I'm not gonna be able to come.
Now, Tilden, a Democrat, blamed high taxes. He wanted lower taxes. He blamed high taxes on the Grant administration for their economic downturn and the panic of 1873 that sent the country into an economic depression, which was called in its day the Great Depression.
Just your way.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Before there's another. He was a hard money man, which is basically someone who wanted the currency to be backed by gold or some sort of precious metal, which there were soft money Democrats too. That there was a whole thing. I'm not going to get into a lot of detail on it. And he was also for civil service reform, and that actually crossed party lines. There was a lot of Republicans also, like the mugwumps, like Garfield and things like this, that wanted to get, you know, that wanted civil service reform. And of course, we talked about that in Arthur and Garfield. Mm-hmm. When he was chosen unanimously by the Democrats, they chose Thomas A. Hendricks, who was in the Greeley election as well, to be his running mate. And he was soft money, and it kind of balanced the ticket.
So what were they backing? If it was a soft, like the soft money guys, what were they backing with? Was it just, I mean, because it was like pre-electronic banking, so you can't.
Right.
And they weren't a huge, like, import-export country at this point, well, I don't think. So, like...
Well, they were becoming one.
Okay.
America was becoming one. And so tariffs became a big issue. You definitely see that later with, especially with Cleveland. Tariffs and all these things became an issue. Soft money, again, it's hard to really describe shortly. But now our money isn't really based on anything. It's based off of faith.
Yeah.
Faith in the currency.
You got to have faith.
So if you give it value, it has value. You know what I mean?
Right.
So, yeah. There's a lot of things that go into it. I don't really want to go into the art. We'll do a whole episode where we go into gold standard, the silver, all that stuff we'll go into later.
Isn't there a modern day politician that... Trump just put into office that is like a hardcore like gold standard.
Yeah,
there's a lot of gold standard.
I forget her name.
That's because the globalists they took away the gold standard, so we'd have less buying power. Next, they're going to get us with the vaccine, and then the 5G towers are going to get the Bill Gates chip going, and somehow generate revenue for George Soros based off of ad revenue.
I can't wait.
The cabal of child molesters.
I'm going to get that COVID shot the second they give it to me, because I want that chip in my brain. I'm tired of having my own thoughts. It's the whole
There's
thing.
There's no chip.
One second.
You
One
have
second.
Your opinions, Jerry, and I have mine.
Yeah. So Rutherford B. Hayes was also a quiet, intelligent man. And although he was a self-described ambitious man, his political career had been a milquetoast one. Rut, as he was called, was born in Delaware and raised by his mother and his uncle, his mother's brother, because his father actually died before he was born.
Did he die in the war?
No, his father died for a different reason. His whole life, he was well-liked and well-respected and was generally a likable person by pretty much everybody he met. He graduated from Harvard Law School. He had a small practice in Cincinnati, Ohio. During the Civil War, he had risen through the ranks and actually became a general. Hayes was wounded multiple times. His horse was actually shot out from under him several times, even twice in the same battle.
It's a weird coincidence. Is that such a common occurrence that...
I don't know. It's just weird that it happened twice in the same battle.
He hit my fucking horse with a cannonball, and I'm fucking bounce off of it. Been fine every time.
Yeah. And then after that happened, he was in the Civil War.
Yeah, he was considered by many to be a bona fide war hero, a lot like Ulysses S. Grant.
Or Donald Trump.
Bone spurs.
He's at war with bone spurs his whole life.
Yeah. He actually served a brief stint in the House of Representatives before being elected Ohio governor. Mm. He was an abolitionist. He was a teetotaler and a moderate Republican.
That's dumb.
Do you know what a teetotaler is?
You don't drink alcohol.
It means...
Yeah.
Yeah, you're totally into tea.
You were.
You want to, like, abolish alcohol. Like, you don't want it at all.
And since my name's Tyler, I'm taking it and making it my own thing. So if you're down with me, you're a teetotaler.
A T-Mitch totaler.
Nice. Friend of the show, T-Mitch.
Hi, T-Mitch.
I'm a T-Mitch totaler.
His wife, Lucy, was nicknamed years after this. She was the first... She was nicknamed Lemonade Lucy because she was a teetotaler. And for the lack of booze that was served in the White House during Hayes' presidency.
Presidents that don't drink booze.
Yeah, she was actually the first lady to ever graduate from college.
Huh.
Oh. Yeah. And the last. Yeah.
She was also the first lady to openly go to showers.
Michelle Obama graduated from college.
You expect me to believe that the first lady in office that graduated from college didn't go to a fucking rush party? I don't believe it for a second.
Not back then.
Well, she definitely went to a rush concert.
Yes.
Yeah.
2112 is her favorite record.
There we go.
Tom Sawyer's high on you. Just.
Foreign dignitaries would actually say... Actually, there was one that was said, quote, "Dinner was wonderful. The water flowed like champagne."
Lame.
Snip, snap.
Do you think that Ulysses S. Grant ever was like, "Lucy, you got some explaining to do"?
Yeah.
Female suffrage as well, which is really weird.
She's like,
but yeah, like not.
Call me crazy, but I think we shouldn't be able to vote.
It's like, crazy. I'm too crazy to vote.
They call me hysteria. He watched me drink this glass of pee. Just kidding, it's lemonade.
And yeah, this kind of offended foreign dignitaries, because their customs and stuff
go
with booze. You know, one Russian delegate said that it was the first time he had tasted water in years.
What's on him? Water's good for Russian. You. Also known as Russian water.
Now, the Republican convention was a shit show, as always.
As every Republican convention.
Much like in the coming decades, Roscoe Conkling, the stalwart from New York, and James G. Blaine of the Radical, at the time, guy from Maine, wouldn't budge on their nominees that they wanted, who were, well, themselves. Yeah.
I nominate me.
Yeah. So on the seventh ballot, it was decided that they would go with the safest pick, which was Hayes, and an attorney, William Wheeler, as his running mate.
Well, Conkling didn't want to go with Hayes, and then he found out that his wife was also into lemons, and he's like, well, when life gives you lemons,
yeah, you gotta vote exactly. Hayes.
Yeah.
You gotta suck a lemon.
He tried to get that on a button, and it was immediately shot down, and, you know.
Neither candidate actually campaigned themselves for the presidency, as was the tradition for the time. They had actually leave it to town criers and their supporters to spread their, you know, spread their campaign policies, which is kind of crazy. We couldn't imagine that at all.
I mean, honestly, now, everything you're talking about, even like the Republicans are saying this, the Democrats are saying this, it was like, this is in like just totally different than anything we're dealing with now.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I mean, as far as the specifics, but.
Right, right. Yeah, same problems, right?
Right.
Now, considering the rising tensions in the nation, many speeches in support of either side would be called, is this type of politicking called waving the bloody shirt, which meant that they should remember that, this was a saying at the time, not every Democrat was a Confederate, but every Confederate was a Democrat.
Yeah.
And to, quote, vote the way they shot.
Damn.
Whoa. Yeah.
Wow.
Whoa.
This was a hairy time. You know, people were looking down the barrel of another Civil War. A lot of people thought there was going to be another Civil War.
So what you're saying is all the people... looking down the barrel of a lot more than that.
So what you're saying is the South, the time, were predominantly Democrat.
Well, and, you know, the Republicans... regardless of which fractious part of the Republican Party you were on at the time, they considered all Democrats the same, and Democrats considered all Republicans the same. You know,
yeah.
So there you go.
Just like now.
So on Election Day in 1876, in the highest voter turnout in American history of 81%, which is crazy. It was looking like Tilden was carrying the popular vote and probably had enough electoral votes to win. And both Hayes and Tilden went to bed on election night thinking that Tilden had won. Hayes himself even graciously conceded to Tilden before frantic wires from the Republican headquarters told him to stop doing that.
No shit.
And I'll explain why here in a second. So on election night, the returns weren't looking great for the Republicans. And Zachariah Chandler, the chairman of the Republican Party, actually, he went to bed with a bottle of whiskey that night as his only companion, is what they said, depressed at looking at the returns.
His wife went to go stay with their mother. That's all I was going to say. Have fun nice. With your bottle of whiskey, Zacharias. Taking the kids.
Zachariah.
Zachariah. I'm taking the kids and I'm staying at my sister's house.
Yeah.
Zachariah Chandler, you know, going to bed with a bottle of whiskey is like me throughout every day of 2020.
Yeah.
You're like Zagreus fucking Matthew Perry or whatever going to bed
Pythagorean with
whiskey
Perry.
Is like me every night. I just repeated your
actually,
joke. I just wanted to call him Zagreus Matthew Perry.
Look, I mean, baby wants his baba. That's all I'm going to say.
He's like, could I be any more depressed and drunk? Because, you know.
Could I be any more losing this election?
Yeah. In a strange twist of fate, a famed Civil War general, Dan Sickles, who I actually want to do a whole episode on, he's fascinating. He actually had a peg leg.
Cool.
He was leaving the late show of a play, and he decided to pass by Republican headquarters, and he kind of found it empty, and he's like, what the fuck? This is election night. And he goes in, and they're like, oh yeah, Zachariah Chandler, he went to bed with a bottle of whiskey, nothing's going on, it's not looking good. And so he started, like, you know, looking around at the returns and stuff, and he's like, none of this is certain here, you know? And he found out that the New York Times got a message that from the Democrats that were like, hey, show us your results. And the New York Times that was starting to call it for Tilden, they were like, wait, they don't know?
Yeah.
Oh, shit. Let's stop saying anything. And, like, they started, like, wait a minute, and shit started to go down.
Huh.
But yeah, Sickles, just a couple of quick things about Sickles. He had a peg leg, a cannonball tore his leg off during the war.
Sweet.
He actually murdered Francis Scott Key's son or nephew or something like that in broad daylight. Yeah,
like, how
first
about
time
a $4 spangled splatter?
Yeah, he was sleeping with his wife or something. And
I mean, fair.
He killed him in broad daylight. And he was the first person to ever claim temporary insanity in a court case.
Huh.
And he won.
Cool.
He's like, I still have to kill him,
anyway,
I'm still temporarily insane.
So Sickles realized about at the time the New York Times did, which was a Republican paper at the time, they both realized that it looked like Tilden was ahead, but no one, not even the Democratic Party, was certain. And what happened was, the Democratic Party called up the New York Times, and they were like, give us your results. And the New York Times, that was already, like, ready to call it for Tilden, they were like, wait a minute, they don't know? And they were like, maybe this is still in the air. Maybe this is still contested. Like, let's figure this shit out.
Everybody at casual.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
You remember, so there's essentially one dude who's like, right away be like, yeah, I won. Stop counting.
Well, no.
I'm just making it for
reference.
Yeah,
I know.
He wasn't even leading when he said
that. Yeah. Tilden was definitely leading.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Almost had President Tilden.
Yeah, yeah.
Tilda
There's been
Swinton.
Weirder names. There's been weirder
Some
names.
Some weird president names.
Yeah.
George Bush?
Yeah, that's like the most normal one there is.
Jimmy Carter, come on.
Yeah. I like they went by Jimmy, though. Not James.
So the three unredeemed states, and, you know, unredeemed means that you're not at the 10% yet.
Yeah.
So there's still military occupation in these states, and mm-hmm. it's still fully under Reconstruction. And those states were Louisiana, Florida, and South Carolina. Those were the contested states.
Mm-hmm.
And this is where all the, like, the main voter suppression, that's where that was really going down to. Yeah, they were disputed.
So who was doing the voter suppression? Was it a flipsy-dipsy? Was it liberals doing it, or was it good old-fashioned conservatives?
White supremacists.
Oh, like always.
Yeah, armed white supremacists.
I'm glad to see that Florida is still in the mix with fucking up shit.
Yeah, yep.
Good thing we got the Voting Rights Act in there and fixed that problem.
Fixed all of it.
Oh, yeah.
Until a couple years ago when we didn't anymore.
The Republicans claimed on one side that black voters and white Republicans were being bullied and suppressed at the polls. Otherwise, they would have had a clear victory, right? And the Democrats claimed that they were trying to steal the election, right? Like, oh, here you are, stealing the election. You know,
stop
it's clearly going for, yeah, it's clearly going for Tilden. And they're like, look, if there was no voter suppression, we would be winning.
Mm-hmm.
So does any of this sound familiar?
The first time I've heard of this.
I feel like maybe we were born and grew up in a bubble where we just had it way too good.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Most of the time, everything's shitty and chaotic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty nuts. Now, politicians across the political spectrum flocked to these three states to resolve the issue. Democratic Party officials wanted Tilden to do more about what they saw as rampant voter fraud. So they were like, Tilden, you gotta get up there and you gotta be like, this is fraud. And he was like, look, this is the way our system works. We have to respect the system. And so, like, they were like, well, you're not gonna fight for it? And he's like, we have to respect the system.
Twitter hasn't been invented yet, guys.
Well, the thing is both Hayes and Tilden were both, had the kind of the same mind. Like, both of them were just like, It's the way things work. It's the way things need to be.
Yeah.
Like, neither of them were fighting. It was the parties that were fighting. Mm. You know what I mean? Not really the candidates in this case.
Interesting.
Yeah, yeah. So that's different than...
In our case, it's just Donald Trump.
Yeah,
screaming into a void.
Yeah.
It sounds like egos, much like portions, were a little bit smaller back then.
Yes,
so.
Yes, indeed. Yeah, you didn't have some sycophants that were just yes-men that were like, there's a steal happening,
yeah.
Whatever the fuck, that believed in some conspiracy nonsense.
Oh, boy.
Tilden basically wasn't willing to do anything about it because he had respect for the electoral system, and he thought it was a sacred one, and he wasn't going to be the one that was going to be caught fucking with it, you know what I mean? So he wasn't going to touch it, and neither was Hayes. But the Republican Party, they were more powerful and numerous at the time. They just had more money. You know, it was the money party, right?
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
And there was just more of them. Yeah, just more elected Republicans in this time.
They're like, let's fuck some rats, guys.
And the 12th Amendment to the Constitution isn't totally clear on what to do in a situation like this. Basically, what it says is that if there's a contested vote, it has to go to Congress in a joint session with the House and the Senate, and the President of the Senate, which is the Vice President, counts the votes. And that's all it really says. But even if the sitting Vice President is the incumbent, he still counts the votes, which is bonkers.
That's crazy.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It is. And the thing was, remember, that the House was the Democrats in this time, and the Senate was the Republicans, much like what we have today. So they couldn't agree on who should ratify the count. Because again, you had sets of electors from these states that were claiming for Tilden, some claiming for Hayes, and there were these sets that were going to win each state, and they were both claiming to be totally legitimate, and somebody had to figure out who these electors were going to actually go to.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And cars don't exist yet.
Like, no.
I really want to focus on, if they want to figure out the corruption, like, they got to, like, get in a horse-drawn carriage and go to each place one by one and get shit sorted
They got
out.
A railroad.
Okay, they do have the choo-choo.
Yeah.
They do have the choo-choo.
They also have telegraph lines.
Okay.
So when they can't agree on who's actually going to count the vote, you know, because the House wants to count it, and of course they're going to count it for Tilden,
mm-hmm.
and the Senate wants to count it, and they're going to count it for Hayes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so no one could agree. And the thing was, is that, you know, Election Day was the same day, you know, it's been to this day, but Inauguration Day wasn't until March.
Right.
So they had a few months to figure it out. And this would drag on for months. Months and months and months. So they had basically until March 4th.
Because that was Inauguration Day, right?
That was Inauguration Day. To figure it all out. Otherwise, what they would have to do is call another election.
Oh, Jesus fuck.
And nobody fucking wanted that. Especially the American people.
Yeah, fuck that shit.
Americans love to vote, but we hate to vote twice for the same thing back to back.
I don't think Americans like voting.
That's not true at all. What are you talking about? American Idol? The reason why it's one of the biggest things is because you know people what? Like voting.
Then why do we have still, like, 66% of all eligible voters voting?
Because if we could vote for a president by dialing yes to 6377, then, and there was a reality show,
exactly.
There is a reality show, right? It's called The News.
Right, now it's a fucking reality show, but...
Without TV, they had 81% voter turnout rate in
this
election.
What else are you gonna do, throw rocks at trains?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure, no TV. But again, no TV, 81% turnout, right?
Yeah,
so, there's not enough rocks or enough trains. So that's why you go and vote.
I don't think people actually do like voting. I think when people get mad enough, that's when they want to vote. I think it takes anger to vote. You know what I mean? Well, I think people have to get pissed off to vote. Yeah. I don't think anyone happily votes.
I think that's absolutely the case.
That's fair enough, yeah.
Well, it's definitely...
They're like, why should I vote? Things are going so well.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't care what happens. Fuck it. You know, like, I know that there's a lot of people that have been that way for a long time. Like, fuck it. Doesn't really affect me.
Well, I used to think
that's
that.
That's why my life motto has always been anger ain't a mood. It's a goddamn way of life.
Yeah, right.
And I'm an angry motherfucker.
Well, if each administration changes one thing that affects your life.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, I think it really depends. Like, the next administration is going to some degree affect, you know, student loan debt. The previous administration really affected immigration, really affected taxes, and actually, in a lot of ways, Donald Trump has gotten a lot of shit done, but it's all been shit that's going to completely kick the legs out from under everybody who is an immigrant and everybody who makes less than $70,000 a year.
Yes,
so,
exactly.
Most of us.
Yeah. Well, it's the backbone of the economy.
Yeah.
So, of course, that has the most money, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So you can tax that, right?
Well, yeah.
And not the super rich, right?
No.
It makes no sense to me, honestly.
My favorite thing about this whole thing is how much money Donald Trump is making.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I know.
What a poor, poor man.
Yeah.
Charging the Secret Service $6.50 a night to stay at Mar-a-Lago.
I know.
That's our dime. That's our dime.
I brought that up last Thanksgiving. Okay, no. Let's just move on. Let's move on. Let's move on.
Yeah. Considering that there were, you know, two electors and whatnot in like, the state, you know, governments, if you have a state legislature that is of a certain party and a governor that is of the same party, then they themselves can decide who the electors actually go towards, right?
Okay.
So the Democrats actually wanted help from the newly elected governors. Like, South Carolina just got a new Democratic governor. His name was Wade Hampton.
Okay.
And actually, Susie went to Wade Hampton High School in Greenville, South Carolina.
There you go.
And, so he's kind of a big deal.
He was a Confederate general and an absolute piece of shit.
Well, you can be a big deal. You can be a big deal and be a piece of shit.
Yeah, the red shirts.
Kanye West.
Stalin.
Yeah, remember I was saying the red shirts were kind of one of the white supremacist groups that were, like, outbullying people?
Yeah. Yeah.
The red shirts in South Carolina basically got him elected. He never actually said, like, gave support to the red shirts. He was, like, too politically savvy for that. But... yeah, they got him elected.
He was real.
They're very fine people.
But by red shirts, you mean classic Proud Boys?
Yeah. Yeah. Proto Proud Boy.
As long as they're not part of the away team, I think they'll be okay.
I get it. Star Trek.
Yeah. Star Wars reference, guys.
Yeah.
It's Star Trek. He's making a joke. He knows Star it's Star Trek. Trek.
What am I? A Wookiee?
A Wookiee.
I think it had something to do with, like, you know, waving the bloody shirt, you know, that kind of a deal. But the thing was, is, like, he didn't get power until everyone else did, too. So there's nothing Wade Hampton could have done to help him out, you know.
Right.
And it's all because of, you know, they had mismatches in these three states, too, because they were still under Reconstruction. Because no one could agree, and there was no, like, political loophole anywhere that they could dash through, what they decided is to compromise. And what they did is they formed a committee to investigate and basically come up with the winner. And so they were going to form this bipartisan committee. It was made up of 15 people, okay? And it was 5 senators, 5 Supreme Court justices, and 5 members of the House. And they were all supposed to be evenly split with one independent voter that and they were going to decide, right? Mm-hmm. Basically where these electors went.
The committee was made up of all women with very small breasts. And I think you guys know what the committee was called. Which, by the way,
where are you going with this?
Is the Itty Bitty Titty Committee, is it a group of women that have itty bitty titties? Or is it a group of just people who scrutinize itty bitty titties?
That is a good question.
Anyway, let's move on.
Among them were actually the two friends, John Sherman and James A. Garfield, on this committee. And if you remember correctly, James A. Garfield, when he first went to the Republican National Convention, and he actually got the nomination, he went there originally supporting John Sherman.
Yeah.
And that's how he didn't like Mondays.
Lasagna, you know, the whole thing.
I was thinking of the song about the girl that shot up a elementary school.
Oh. Yeah.
And she did it because she didn't like Mondays.
Yeah. Is that a song?
Yeah, Boomtown Rats.
Oh, well, I thought you were talking about Manic Carpenters. Monday.
I thought you were thinking of Manic Monday.
I was thinking of the Carpenters' Rainy Days and Mondays.
Yeah. Or U2's... No, wait, no, that's Sunday Bloody Sunday.
Yeah. Fuck, different day of the week.
I'm done. Days are hard.
Yeah.
Now, the swing vote. The most important vote was supposed to be the new Supreme Court Justice David Davis.
Mm. What a name.
He was a big dude. He was a big old guy.
He was a big dude with a simple name that was easy to remember because his parents did not love him. They're like, fuck it, David.
Yeah.
David Dum Dum Davis.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Does the D also stand for David? No, it stands for Dum Dum because my parents didn't love me very much.
But he very smartly resigned from the investigation as soon as he could. Because he's like, no way am I going to be the guy that's going to decide the election and have half the country fucking hate me.
So it wasn't that much of a dum-dum.
Yeah, there's no fucking way I'm doing that.
I won't touch this election with the stick that I attach a rag to wash myself with.
Now, everyone eventually voted along party lines, unsurprisingly, making the vote 8-7 for Hayes.
Bada bing.
Right. Only the Republicans were happy about it. There were stirrings of violence yet again. And the Tilden supporters, they threatened to take the White House by force and install Tilden as president.
Oh. Like,
this was happening. So, Grant, of course, called in federal troops just in case. Jesus Christ. Just in case anything would happen.
Glad that that's not a worrisome thing nowadays.
Oh, yeah. I'm glad that our cities don't have federal troops in them.
Repelling.
Keeping the peace.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Beating people with batons.
Yeah. That would be a whole thing.
I mean, it's all about guessing. Growth, you know? Like,
yeah. Guessing your own people, that's cool.
I'm glad that never happened.
Yeah, yeah.
Certainly never happened on Capitol Hill.
It's all hunky-dory. You know what I'm glad to hear? Is that the Proud Boys care so much about Capitol Hill. I didn't know that they cared so much about Capitol Hill until now.
Yeah.
Right. It's just crazy to know, honestly.
Who would have thunk that,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
A little gay neighborhood.
A
gay artist neighborhood.
A gay artist neighborhood. It's crazy that they're down there all, you know, they live down there and that they hang out down there all the time and they care so much about it. You know, it's like, wow. Honestly.
It's almost like I didn't even know that they were there before this whole thing started.
It's almost like they weren't. Like they were invisible. Like they weren't there.
Like
they didn't support any of the businesses around there or anything.
Yeah, it almost...
It's kind of that way,
it almost
right?
feels like as if they drove, you know, the fucking 2.5 hours from Woodby Island to, to go and hang out.
Yeah, drove...
The four days from St. Pete's, Florida.
I don't know. Eastern Washington. I don't fucking know. I don't know where they come from, but they don't come from fucking Capitol Hill. Anyway, they can fuck right off. All of them can
fuck
right
off. Fuck you, Proud Boys.
Yeah. So to stall the ratification of the decision by the commission, the Democrats started an epic filibuster to contest every single electoral vote. Even if it wasn't disputed. So they'd basically be like, that vote in this state, I contest that vote. And then they would have to go all the way through it and show why it's not contested, just to stall the whole system until March.
God. So they had Patton Oswalt there, just doing the fucking Star Wars.
Oh no, it was back in the day, so it was like, he was like, let me tell you about how Jules Verne should have an interconnected literary universe and how all of his books are connected. All right, point one. 20,000 Leagues of Adventure.
Well, I mean, this is before there was, like, laws against certain things you could do in a filibuster. Like, you couldn't just get up there and read the Bible. There's people that would do that. And it was just a stall. And that's all they were doing. They were just stalling until March. The thing was, is they kind of wanted another election. Nobody else wanted that. Just them. Mm-hmm. And that's really it. Here's the kicker of this whole thing. This is the biggest kicker. In a last-minute Hail Mary pass, high-up party officials from both parties met secretly and discussed what would happen next. 2 days before the deadline of Inauguration Day, the Compromise of 1877 was reached. It wasn't totally official, but it's what was decided. And it basically broke the filibuster and ended the filibuster so Congress could ratify what the commission decided. They were going to go with Hayes as president.
Cool.
For this compromise. Here's the kicker, though. Hayes had to promise to end military occupation in the South and end Reconstruction.
Mm.
So, basically...
Are we sure that's just it? Maybe they didn't get some extra grease in their palms?
If there was... I mean, none of it's written down, but if there was, Hayes didn't really do anything else with his presidency to show anything like that. So what happened was, is since... They all agreed that this would happen. So since March 4th was actually on a Sunday that year, and inauguration was actually moved to Monday because, you know, God's Day...
Mm-hmm.
Hayes was actually secretly sworn in on Saturday the 3rd, just so that Democrats couldn't try any funny business. He's already been sworn in. I guess that matters.
Very sneaky.
I just, like, we already made him promise he was president. So you can't do anything else.
It's you, like, guys, you promised! Yeah.
It's just, it's like, you already sworn, okay, whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Rutherford B. Hayes became president with an air of fraudulency. A lot of people called him his fraudulency. Like, they called him a fraud. Whoa. He had the whole air of, like,
not my being president.
Not being a legitimate president.
He was born in Kenya.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he kind of resolved to kind of keep his head down as president for this reason. He was going to be a laissez-faire president.
With your heads down, how are you going to dodge all the tomatoes?
Well, it's already down.
That's all.
Below the podium, you know?
Yeah. Now, instead of actually going in there and, like, fixing civil service and actually giving real reform, we kind of touched on this, too. He kind of tried to, like, smooth things out and give the New York Customs House to the Democrats.
Right.
And so he battled Roscoe Conkling his entire presidency, all 4 years, over this. And Roscoe Conkling crushed him. He ruined his reputation. Totally fucking crushed him.
He got conked.
He got conked.
Yep. And Hayes also honored the commitments of the Compromise and ended Reconstruction. And what this did is it undid all of the work in the last decade that was done for the South, and it handed everything back to the Democrats.
Mm.
And again, this is only, you know, it's in recent memory,
where
the Civil War is. And these are people that you've been fighting, and you just handed it all back to them and said, you promised to be nice? They said, yep. And they decided to make all their states' rights laws from then on until the 1960s. There used to be such a thing as, you know, black legislatures, things like this.
Yeah.
Not so after this.
Mm-hmm.
Not so.
They had like that.
They had one decade of
something resembling
progress.
Equity and progress.
Yeah.
And with that compromise of 1877, sorry.
Mm-hmm.
1 year after the centennial, all of that was unraveled, and you get the birth of all kinds of voter suppression, all kinds of Jim Crow laws.
Well, you get Jim Crow, but the thing was, a lot of these white supremacist groups, because they were considered terrorist organizations under the Grant administration, they kind of disappeared for a long time. They were kind of scattered to the wind.
Mm-hmm.
The KKK didn't really exist in 1877. They were kind of gone. And everyone was like, well, guess that's it. And it wasn't until the 20th century that they came back with the vengeance. And that was because of a little movie called
Birth of the Nation. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Woodrow Wilson's favorite movie.
Of course it is.
What a dildo.
Thanks a lot, Lumiere Brothers. You fucking ruined the world.
Lumiere Brothers didn't do that.
Yeah, they made
it Pixar.
I know, but the Lumiere Brothers invented the cinema camera that would later be used by Cecil B.
DeMille. There's a lot of people that invented a lot of different cameras, actually. Well, there's a Lumiere camera.
A lot of people invented a lot of things.
Well, the Lumiere Brothers ruined a train coming into the station. It used to be exciting, and after I saw that movie 50 times, I just didn't care anymore.
Yeah,
Hayes actually promised not to seek a second term. He would say smokescreeny things like, you know, if you seek a second term, your first term is just going to be trying to be reelected, rather than committing to your commitments that got you elected. And it's like, oh, so that one thing, you know what I mean? Oh, he did the Easter egg roll. He started that.
Okay.
Hmm.
So
I love egg rolls.
He violently put down a labor strike with federal troops.
Yeah.
So there's that. Kind of cost him some political clout. Luckily, there was like a bona fide genius that was coming on next, which was James Garfield.
Mm-hmm.
That could write Latin and Greek with, you know, Latin in one hand and Greek in the other at the same time. Like, the dude was a genius. It's too bad what happened to him.
Mm-hmm.
Go back and listen to that if you want, if you haven't.
Yeah.
Many called the election stolen and taken from Tilden. And Samuel Tilden, for the greater good of the country, conceded. But the country had not yet seen the last of him. He would stay in politics for many years to come. He doesn't fade away. He stays in the zeitgeist of America.
planning, scheming.
Running just, for president. Yeah. You know, all things like this. Hayes, after he was president, would outwardly say that he was content with his presidency. There's not another president that's ever entered the White House under worse circumstances and left under so good a circumstances.
We'll see.
And it's like, I don't know about that.
I'm the best that there ever has been, that there ever will be.
I don't think he was.
Everyone likes me.
He wasn't a total narcissist. He did retire, you know, right afterwards. Mm. He did keep up correspondence with a lot of people in Congress. He's still a very visible figure in America. And he actually wrote extensively about how he did his best with what he was given, and he ultimately didn't really deserve any of the ire that was directed at him. You know, like with what Conkling and some of the stalwarts were doing.
Mm-hmm.
He said he didn't deserve that.
I didn't deserve getting conked.
Yeah. I believe in his official, you know, letters, it was mostly just, come on, guys, come on.
Yeah.
I did my best.
Don't conk me again.
I can't take another conking.
Yeah. Well, it wouldn't take long before old Roscoe got a conk in himself.
Oh. So. The conkings have turned.
Yeah. But enough about his wife.
Roscoe cheated on his wife.
Oh.
No, he's conking on the side.
So with the new promising candidate to take his place, James Garfield, as we know, many were glad to finally throw Rut Hayes aside. And the 1876 election may have been over, but the country would never really totally be done with it.
Mm-hmm.
To this day, we're not really done with 1876.
Well, how about that?
So...
They biffed that one.
Yeah.
That's a botched job.
That's a botched job.
I feel like today I learned that what we're going through currently, and we try not to date our episodes, but this is November of 2020, end of November, week before Thanksgiving. So, you know, we don't try to date the show, but I just dated us horribly.
Yeah. Yep.
But that being said, that what we're going through now is par for the course, it seems like.
There's just a lot of similarities.
It being just a clean break is not normal.
Well,
and we grew up in a I don't know.
Well, I do want to say that the silver lining in both of these elections is that, these happen to be some of the weirdest elections we've ever had. I mean, we had a fucking sitting vice president kill somebody in a duel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that happened during an election. We've had some crazy elections, but the thing was that you can take away from this is that we're still here. Yeah. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. We made it, you know, after a crazy, contested, totally polarized election. And I mean, we aren't nearly as polarized as they were in 1876. We weren't nearly as polarized.
I thought we were on the verge of civil war.
There's a lot of people that are saying that, and I'm not ruling it out. I'm just saying they already had one, and this is what they were dealing with, and we're not even close to that kind of ire. You know what I mean? We're not even close to that kind of division in this country.
I mean, I don't know about that so much. Tell that to Portland. My buddy last night, his next door neighbor got fucking shot at.
Yeah. Okay, look. It wouldn't make any sense for me to tell anything like that to one city in the country. I understand what's going on in our city and in Portland, but the thing is this is the whole country we're looking at.
Sure.
It's not just one city, and it's not just one state.
Sure.
We have to be... they were physically divided. The Mason-Dixon mm-hmm. line. Physically and ideologically opposite.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So, like, we might have differences, and there might be a lot of these things, and politicians exacerbate these things. But we still are alive. You know, there still isn't a civil war.
Yeah.
So until it happens, then we can talk about that. But so far nothing's happening. I'm not devaluing any, you know, I'm not going to be an alarmist, but I'm also not going to take away fear of that. It's okay to be afraid of things like that happening. It has happened before. There's precedents for that happening. I just don't. We're not anywhere near what this was. Sure. Is my only point that I'm saying.
Sure. What I was trying to say is modern day civil war is not going to look like what it was back then.
Oh, certainly not. Certainly not. But we're not. My only point is, ideologically speaking, we are not nearly as divided as we were back then.
I'm inspired by Jerry's words, and I'd like to bring up that in 2024, Jerry will just barely be 35 years old, and he's born in the United States. So I'm not saying that he's making a run yet, but that's because he's only like two beers deep right now. So let's give him a couple more, see where it goes.
I've said that behind the scenes of the show that I think the sort of the fear that we're going to have a civil war in this country sometime soon is really extreme, and I don't believe it at all. I think that there's a huge difference between, like, small pockets and groups of... I think there'll be violence. There'll be a lot of violence, but I think there's a huge difference between that and even, like, guerrilla tactics-esque... Sorry, let me just finish.
Yeah, go for it.
For people to be... I think it's almost impossible in this country right now for people to be connected enough to create a large enough act of violence where it's like it can be actually considered a civil war.
Well, they you touch on a very important point. What you're talking about is like ideological solidarity. And the thing is there's really no ideological solidarity with, let's just say, Republicans and Democrats.
Okay? Right.
Because in the Civil War, it was parties that separated. Mm-hmm. Like the saying was, is not every Democrat was a Confederate, but every Confederate was a Democrat, right?
Mm-hmm.
So like that's kind of what we're looking at. And the thing is we might see violence and voter suppression just like in the election of 1876, but we won't see war like the Civil War in America ever again. Probably ever again.
Oh, I don't think so at all.
Unless shit gets really bad, which I just don't think... I think
events would have to happen that are so drastic we can't see them coming.
Yeah.
I think... for me, it's like... When people say things, it's like, well, a modern civil war is a different thing. I still don't think that, like, the most we're going to get... We will get violence. There will be shootings. And that will continue to happen in the United States because they're not doing anything about it. Yeah. That is not a civil war. And I think for those people to become...
insurgency is what that is.
For those... They'd have to, like... There'd have to be a coalition amongst these people who would have to be organized enough to actually have it be a civil war. Well, and I don't see that happening in this country.
Well, and again, a coherence of one ideology.
Yeah.
Which
and for that to be... For that to be... If that... I think that... I think there's a reason that we haven't had a major terrorist attack in this country since 9/11... is the same reason that's not going to happen. It's like, these people are being watched, you know? The intelligence agencies, if they got large enough that there's a coalition of people who could actually do some real damage in this country, I don't buy that the way things are right now, that would be possible.
Well, here's the way I think of it. There are militia groups that will probably do insurgent-like things, you know?
Mm-hmm.
If they get real nuts... They'll do like an Oklahoma City bombing thing or a Ruby Ridge thing or things like
that. But my point is, if that is what you consider a civil war, then we have been in a civil war ever since the Civil War.
Exactly. Exactly.
If that's what you call a civil war, then we already have been in a civil war.
We've never left.
So it's never, it's not, there's not going to be a civil war. And then I think by being like, this is going to happen, you're decrediting what's already happened, where it's like Oklahoma City or, you know, Al-Qaeda, all these things.
Need
to be taken fucking seriously.
By the way, that family after the Al-Qaeda thing moved to my hometown, and now they're claiming to be from my hometown of Emmett, Idaho, which they are not from. I am from there, and I don't remember a single motherfucking one of them, and I hope they get run out of that town on a rail. And I hope you're listening, Emmett, Idaho. Fuck the Bundy family and get them the fuck out of my hometown. It offends me that their presence is even there.
The cat agrees with you.
God damn.
Sorry.
She came up to you while you were yelling. She was like,
and just to be
I know,
just,
right?
Just to be clear, We love the Bundys, Al Bundy, Peg in particular. I love
yeah. Peg,
but it's the other Bundys, you know,
the shithead Bundys,
Ted Bundy. Yeah, you know, he's
the shithead
great.
Bundys.
Anyway. I did not expect you to say he's great.
He's awful. He's an awful person.
Cliven and the rest.
Now, gentlemen, I know that every year around the holidays, you gotta speak to, you know, maybe members of your family or friends that, you know, you may not totally agree with, you know, their worldview or what they have to say. But the thing is we're gonna set an example. And we're gonna talk with someone that we don't necessarily agree with, but we wish them happy holidays even still. And a happy
Donald Trump, right?
No, yep. No, no.
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, Roger Stone.
No, we're gonna call the cowman.
Ah,
fuck you. Really?
Yeah,
of all
yeah,
the
we're
people.
Call I know. You guys don't want to talk to the cowman, but we're gonna talk to the cowman. This is how it's gonna go.
Well, I don't so much like talking to him, but I do like listening to what he has to say. He has a lot of controversial opinions that I'm a pretty, you know, I'm an avid listener. I have been for a long time, so it's gonna be really exciting for me.
All right. So let's call the cowman. Cowman, are you there?
Hey, all right. I just gotta know real quick. Is this a serious interview?
Yeah. We just wanted to say how are you doing there, cowman?
Oh, all right. Well, you know, that's nice for change. I'm doing the whole rodeo, you know, in 15 minutes. You get me?
Okay. All right.
No.
So, what are you doing for Thanksgiving, cowman?
Well, Thanksgiving, I'm not into it. Me and my closest, we celebrate something that we call Thanksribbing. That's where we like to, take one of those leftover ribs, you know, from those whaling ships from Japan. We go to town on just one of those. And that's how we celebrate the holiday, whole milk and all.
All right, whole milk and a whale rib.
The side of spermaceti.
Oh, yeah.
It sounds like this Thanksgiving for you is going to be ribbed for your pleasure.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Ironically, no one will see our ribs because those whale ribs are ginormous.
That sounds good. Cowman, tell me about your podcast that you have.
Our podcast, is there to discover the truth and sometimes to create the truth. Safe spaces have wanted posters of the cowman. It's a country slaughterhouse. And that's what we like to stand for.
Yes. You wouldn't be a proponent of safe spaces or of free speech jails, right?
Well, I'm into saying mostly whatever you want. Yeah, safe spaces, I'm like, geez, come on.
What I mean, it's a show that really separates the cowmen from the cowboys, from what I understand.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Cowboy is my brother. He owns a car dealership, and I don't like to talk about him, even though I love him very much.
Yeah. Fair enough. Well, have you listened to our podcast? And if so, what do you think?
Yeah, history is for the boys. I'm sure that all of you can agree with me on that.
All of our listeners are history boys, even the girls. That's why we spell it B-O-I-Z.
Yes.
But, you know.
And history, mainly favors mostly, you know, with some exceptions, the boys.
God damn it.
Do you agree with our reading of history there, cowman?
I do. I would say that I agree Until I disagree.
I see. I see. Well, what do you have any thoughts on the election or current events there?
Everyone is really just, I think they're overreacting a little bit. It doesn't really matter because either way I voted, I can just lie to you. Depending on the situation. And right. I think that's what makes America beautiful.
Who did you vote for, Cowman?
I'm a firm advocate of my pal, Bill Bob Butch. He's run locally for the last 25 years. I vote for him for everything in every form of voting.
You just write him in for everything.
Yeah. He's got my firm support. Bill Bob Butch. 2024 ?
What of his policies is most popular with you? Why do you like him so much?
My favorite policy of his is to expose them all, every one of them, and also to get our boys back from Nam, because he's convinced that there's still some of them over there, and he'll go back for them.
I think the boys that are in Nam right now are willing to stay there.
They might be, but there's only one way to find out, and that's another one of his campaign slogans. Only one way to find out.
It's been absolutely great talking with you, Cowman. Your podcast...
I love you, Cowman.
Yeah.
I love you, Cowman.
Cowman's podcast is Cowman's Country Slaughterhouse, and where can that be found there, Cowman?
It can be found on YouTube through the parent channel Nubby Nader, or you can just type in Cowman's Country Slaughterhouse.
Only available on YouTube there, folks, because Cowman, I wouldn't say is probably the most technologically savvy person out there.
No, we like to keep it simple. We like to keep it real.
Yeah, that's for the real folks out there. Well, that's fair. That's that, to each his own there. Anyway, it's been great talking with you, Cowman. Hopefully we'll talk to you again sometime soon.
Thank you for having me.
All right.
So, folks, got a couple of new Patreon supporters, Patreon pals, that we want to shout out. The first one I want to shout out is Danny.
Danny!
Woo! Yeah, buddy. Thank you so much, Danny. Danny's been, we've never met him personally, but Danny's been a great friend of the show for a long time.
Recommended some apps.
We did a couple
good
of
things, and we love you.
He just harps on and on and on about things we have to do.
But we love doing them.
He has great ideas.
For sure.
Thank you so much, Danny. It means a lot to us. And we also have Ian! I actually got to talk with Ian on the Beers of the Boys on Discord. That guy's pretty dope. I like that guy.
Yeah, and just so you know, if you're not a Patreon pal yet, become a Patreon pal to get access to our Discord and hang out with us when we do Beers with the Boys, any History Boys or History...
History persons,
history peoples.
Well, and guys, I was afraid of Discord too. I know it's a new thing, and I don't like new things. I hate new things. But honestly, Discord is pretty cool. I kind of dig it.
The young people hearing you say Discord is this new thing, they're like, you old fuck.
I know.
Okay, boomer.
I know. And we also have Maddie.
What's
up, Maddie?
Maddie is the sister I never had.
Yeah. Maddie is great. Wonderful. I love her.
I love Maddie. She was on, she was one of your groomsmen.
Yeah, she was.
Yeah.
Yeah. She was a grooms person
grooms
of mine.
Grooms person.
And grooms woman. I don't know how you want to put it.
I kind of just went like groomsman.
Groomsman.
And we went to
groomsman's
her
fine.
Personally to shake her down, get her on the Patreon. And if you play your cards right, we'll come shake you down too.
Yeah.
So get in there, get in the chat with us. And get the cool free stuff that we're giving away.
We got hey guys, we got merch now. We got shirts.
Oh yeah.
We got an A-line dress with our
just
faces
in time
on
for Christmas. If you want to get somebody a dope ass History Boys, whatever.
What the fuck?
All kinds of things on there.
We got a bunch of shit, and it's kind of awesome. We got a few people that already got it, and they seem to like it, so that's pretty cool.
First person who gets the A-line dress will be featured all over our social media accounts.
Yes, you have to send a picture. If you get that A-line dress, please take a picture of yourself in it so we can share that all over. Because it's bonkers. I'm just going to say, I bonkers.
Love it. Bonkers isn't a bad thing.
No. I was History Boys t-shirt buyer, customer number one, and I love my shirt. I wear it every single day.
It's starting to smell.
It's starting to smell. It's rotting and falling off my bones. I gotta buy another one now.
Don't be like Tyler. Buy one and wash it every once in a while. That's what normal people
you
do.
You take care of it, it'll take care of you.
Yeah. I don't even know what that means.
So, actually, what we did do is we recorded some new stuff for our Patreon pals. We did a quiz show.
Oh, yeah.
Which was a lot
of fun. That's coming
out soon. That's on Patreon, so that'll be cool. But yeah, otherwise, follow us on all the social medias. You know, your Twitters, your Instagrams, your Facebooks, and you can interact with us there. You can see all sorts of stuff that we post. But otherwise, I am Jerry Nash, and I'm a history boy. I hope you enjoyed this show. Boy, we had some difficulties making this episode.
I don't want to talk about it.
I don't want to talk about it either.
Stop fucking bringing it up, Jerry.
And yeah, that's it for me.
I'm Tyler Armentrout, and I'm a history boy, and I approve this message.
There you go. I'm Chris Whedon, also history boy. Have a good night, everyone. I love you very much.
And I'm Zach Meck, the angriest of the history boys. And on that note, love you, bye. We had a lot of fun. We'll see you next time. Or I guess we won't.